Hey everyone, you're gonna have to bear with me. This is my first time back recording ever since I got sick, so my voice might sound a little off. But I've been having cabin fever here, not being able to really do anything because I couldn't go to work, and I couldn't really record because I couldn't talk. This is my first day back with an actual voice, so I'm gonna make an attempt to do this. But anyway, let's get into this. This is gonna be part four of What If Ash Was Born in Kalos. I hope you enjoy. Alright, so we pick back up with Ash, Grant, and Alexa. They've been on the road now for about a week, and they're making their way to Geosinch Town. This is their first stop on their way to Ash's site for his next gym badge in Shallower City. Ash is super excited, because him and Grant, they've been having the chance to train together over the last week, and Alexa has been getting a lot of new info for the story she's been writing on these strangely discolored fossil Pokemon. Ash's Kraniados and Grant's Tyrant have developed quite the rivalry. The two like to battle each other head on, and over the last week or so, Grant has worked with Ash and his Kraniados, and Kraniados has learned a new move, Rock Tomb, which has come in very handy considering Kraniados didn't actually have any rock type moves up until this point. The trio finally arrive in a Geosinch Town and immediately head for the Pokemon Center. On their way to the Pokemon Center, they notice something strange about the town. It seems like it's in major disrepair, like it's been attacked repeatedly over the course of the last couple of weeks. It seems like every time they try to make repairs, the repairs are stopped by another attack. Once they get inside the Pokemon Center, they talk to Nurse Joy about what's going on. Nurse Joy informs them that outside of the town, there's a very ancient forest that for hundreds of years hasn't had any life whatsoever in it. The ancient forest is known as the Forest of Desolation. Many centuries ago, it was vibrant with life. But then one day, overnight, all of the life was sucked out of it, and no one knew why. But then, about 3 weeks ago, a strange blue aura came from the forest, and nobody knew what to make of it. And being that everybody in the town is very superstitious, nobody wanted to go and investigate. But then, out of nowhere, Pokemon started attacking the town. Random ones that they had never seen in the area before. And even though they've been trying to make repairs to the town, every time they start, they get attacked again, and they don't know why. But the attacks have been happening less and less frequent over the past couple of days. It seems like some of the Pokemon have moved on, and there's only a couple of them that have been holding out, still attacking the town, but they don't know why they're attacking. Ash, Grant, and Alexa decide that this is something that needs to be checked out. So, the next morning, the three decide to head into the forest. Once they get into the forest, they notice large stone pillars that line the walkway heading towards the forest, and there's a mirror right at the beginning of the path. And it's written in an ancient language that nobody understands. Ash asks what this is, and Grant informs Ash that he's heard rumors about this. There's many mysteries surrounding these giant stone pillars, but the one that's most intriguing is that he thinks that these are the gravestones of Pokemon that fell in a war that happened in Kalos over 3 millennia ago. Ash is surprised by this. He had never heard of any war growing up back in Amber Town, but being that this doesn't really tie into anything that they're trying to do right now, the trio opt to move on past it. Once they make their way past all of the stone pillars, they come to a land that is desolate. This is weird because the land goes from vibrant green to desolate with no life. Then off in the distance, it looks like an oasis in the middle of nowhere to where life has begun starting to emerge in the center of this forest desolation. As the trio are staring off in the distance trying to make heads or tails of what's going on in this situation, Ash can see in the distance something coming towards them at blinding speed. It seems to be a Pokemon and it's rushing towards them. Ash tries to point it out to both Alexa and Grant. And they both, after some time, can see it. This Pokemon speeds past them with blinding velocity, and it's heading in the direction of the town. Ash thinks, oh great, this must be one of the Pokemon that was attacking the town. Ash turns to Grant and Alexa and says, listen, we need to get back to the town. That thing is probably heading there to attack it some more. And if there's one, there's probably more. Grant and Alexa both agree, and the trio head back to the town. It takes some time, but they finally do arrive back in Geosinch Town. But unfortunately, they're too late. There's buildings that have been destroyed, and there's piles of rubble everywhere. But the Pokemon is still there. They can see it zipping past them, left, right, and it's just firing what seems to be like percussions at things. Alexa can feel it. They're like sonic booms, kind of like what Noivern lets out whenever it uses its boom burst. Alexa thinks to herself, this is odd, but then she thinks, maybe Noivern can counter this, so she sends it out. Once Noivern erupts from the ball, she orders it to use a boom burst. Noivern lets out a loud roar, and the boom burst counters the sonic booms that are coming from the Pokemon, and an explosion erupts the town. Once Noivern flaps its giant wings, it clears the dust. Then the Pokemon becomes visible. It was caught in the blast, and it was knocked unconscious. Ash looks at it, and he whips out his Pokedex. And it reads, Yanma, the Clearwing Pokemon. Its eyes can see 360 degrees without moving its head. It won't miss prey, even those behind it. Ash thinks, Yanma, and he looks at this Yanma. It's unconscious on the ground. And then he looks at the one in the Pokedex. They don't look anything alike. And then Ash clicks over to the shiny version. And again, they don't look the same. Alexa and Grant both notice this as well. The trio are stumped by this, and Ash Ash asks Alexa or Gran if they've ever seen anything like this, and they both said no. Ash says, well, listen, we gotta get to the Pokemon Center. So Ash picks up Yama, and they head to the Pokemon Center. Once inside, they get it to Nurse Joy. She takes it into the ER. After a while, Nurse Joy does reemerge, and she tells them that Yama's gonna make a full recovery. But it's odd, and Alexa says, what do you mean? Nurse Joy says, when inspecting this Yama, it seems to have attributes of the fairy typing, which is weird because it should have nothing to do with the fairy typing. It's nowhere close in its DNA. It's very odd. She asks Ash where he found it, and Ash tells Nurse Joy that they went out to investigate the forest, and once they got to the forest, they realized that in the center of this Forest of Desolation, there was a giant green patch, and this Yama had come from it. Nurse Joy says, that's very, very strange. She says, Yama will make a full recovery, but it's going to need a day or two to rest. Ash says, well, at least that's a relief. But he does say that this is one of the Pokemon that had to have been attacking the city, because when we got here, that's all it was doing. But we don't know why. Alexa, in her reporter nature, tells Ash and Grant that the answer has to be back in that patch of forest that has all of a sudden turned green. They both agree, and they decide to make their way back to that area. They all agree, but Ash wants to wait here at the Pokemon Center for Yanma to wake up, because he has a feeling that once it wakes up, it might start to attack again, and they may need somebody here to subdue it. Grant and Alexa agree, so those two decide to head out to the forest. It takes them a while to get through the Forest of Desolation and the parts that have died and decayed, but they eventually make it to the green patch, and it's the strangest thing. Flowers are in full bloom, water is running, and it seems that there have been Pokemon that have returned to the site, but there's something else that's here. Upon further inspection of the area, Grant and Alexa come across some familiar faces. Team Flare, and none other than Mabel leading the group. This is odd. Why is Team Flare here? Why is Mabel here? This needs more investigating. The two decide to get closer, trying to figure out what is going on. Grant is especially interested in this. As they get closer, they see that there's a ground zero where it looks like a surge of energy took place, because branches, trees, bushes, they're all pushed out in the direction from that single point. And there, in many cages, are Pokemon, multiple different Pokemon, but they don't seem to have normal coloring. Alexa and Grant both take notes of this, and this piques Grant's interest way more than does Alexa's, and he immediately starts taking notes. Alexa pulls out her video recorder. She's trying to get info on this. She's trying to get as much video evidence on this as possible, because this is the story that she's been waiting for. First, the prehistoric Pokemon with off coloring, and now all of these Pokemon with off coloring. And Team Flare is after these ones as well. What is going on in the Kalos region? What are these Pokemon, and what importance do they have to Team Flare? Back at the Pokemon Center in Geosinchtown, Yanma wakes up. And of course, just like Ash thought, it is not happy. It immediately starts letting out sonic boom after sonic boom, destroying the room that it's in. Ash sends out Absol to try and calm it down, but unfortunately, Yama's bug typing gives it the advantage, and after a signal beam hits Absol, it manages to put it down and causing a lot of damage. Ash doesn't like where this is going, and Yanma sees Ash as a threat, as he just ordered Absol to attack it. So Yama focuses all of its aggression on Ash. Ash has no choice. He sends out Kreniados to defend himself. Yama tries to rush in and uses another sonic boom, but Kreniados uses its new move, Rock Tomb, to counter, and it deflects the blast, causing a hole in the wall. Yama sees this as a chance to escape, and it makes its way out back into the town, and it starts attacking again, and it starts attacking again. Ash knows he can't let this go on. Ash recalls Absol, and he orders Kreniados to follow him, and the two set off after Yanma. Once they finally catch up, Ash orders a takedown. Kreniados manages to connect, but the problem is Yanma is getting faster. Ash pulls out his Pokedex, and he learns that Yanma's ability is Speed Boost, which allows its speed to increase. Ash thinks to himself, great, this isn't good. At this rate, it's going to be way too fast for us to catch. And that explains why it was moving so fast when it rushed into town to begin with. Ash knows that the only way that he's going to be able to stop this rampage is if he catches it. So he orders Kreniados to head in with a headbutt. Yama sees this and is able to easily dodge it. But Ash was hoping for this, and he orders Kreniados to use a Rock Tomb in the direction that Yanma had dodged, and it worked. It captures Yanma securely, but it doesn't hold it for long. After a few sonic booms, it's able to break free of its rock prison, but it's clear that it is extremely exhausted. It still hasn't recovered from the boom burst it took when it battled Alexa's Noivern, and that Rock Tomb took even more out of it. Ash thinks, alright, we have to put an end to this. He needs Kreniados to get in quick. Ash orders Kreniados to lower its head the whole way to the ground and to rush in. Kreniados does so, and Yama doesn't know what to make of it, but it fires multiple sonic booms and signal beams at it, but they just get deflected because Kreniados is keeping its head low to the ground and using it as a shield. It's allowing Kreniados to get in close. Ash then orders Kreniados to use a Rock Tomb one more time. Yanma sees this coming and manages to dodge, but this is what Ash wanted, and he orders Kreniados to use a takedown, which manages to connect with Yanma, knocking it down. Before it can get back up, Ash throws a Pokeball at it. It bounces once It bounces twice, but Yama manages to break free. It's not going to go down without a fight. Ash thinks to himself he's got to do a lot more damage here, otherwise he's not going to be able to stop this Yanma. It's got a lot of power, but it's also got a lot of aggression. But that's alright though. His Kranidos has it too. Ash looks at Kranidos and asks if it's ready. Kranidos looks back at Ash and it nods. He says, alright Kranidos, we need our next move to connect and put down Yanma for good. Kranidos nods and it prepares itself. Ash orders Kranidos to rush in, and along the way, he uses it to use multiple rock tombs. Yanma does its best and he manages to dodge the first couple of them, but it gets caught halfway in the third one, and Ash knows that this is his chance. He orders Kranidos to rush in with full force, using a takedown, knocking into Yanma. This does knock out the bug Pokemon. Ash then throws a Pokeball at it again, and it bounces once, twice, and three times. And Ash has finally caught this Yanma and put an end to the destruction in the town. Back over with Gran and Alexa, they both agree that they have to confront Mabel. They cannot let her take all of these Pokemon, and especially since how these Pokemon seem to be important to something that Team Flare is planning, they make the decision to interfere. Gran decides that he's going to draw their attention with Onix, but there's a problem. All of their cages have electrical locks on them. Alexa says, don't worry, I got this, and she sends out another Pokemon. This is her Helioptile. She says, Helioptile is electric type. It should be able to overload those locks and get those Pokemon free. Grant says, alright then, you sneak behind and I'll draw their attention. Make it quick because I don't know how long we'll be able to last. With that, the two split up. Grant sends out Onix and orders it to attack, getting everybody's attention. Mabel is instantly drawn to this. Grant, the gym leader of Silage City, what are you doing here? Grant turns to Mabel and says, don't you worry about it. The fact that you attack my gym should be reason enough for me to be here. Now, I'm going to say this once. Release the Pokemon and leave this place, or else. Mabel just laughs. Or else what? What are you going to do? You and your big bag Onix. You were barely able to beat us last time, and we far outnumber you this time. Grant says, oh, I may have a few tricks up my sleeve. Don't you worry about that. He orders Onix to use multiple rock tombs. This is something that he had been working on with Ash over the past week or so, just in case they ran into Team Flare again. With that, he's able to drastically cut the numbers of the grunts down by capturing multiples of them in these rock tombs, basically making it so it's just him and Mabel. Mabel looks at him. Impressive. I didn't think that someone like you could think of doing something like that, but it's still not going to matter. And Grant asks her why. She says, because we already have everything that we need here. We were actually just getting ready to leave, and our reinforcements should be here soon, but I will entertain you until they arrive. With that, Mabel sends in her Weavile and her brand new Pokemon, an Electrike. Grant looks at the Electrike, and it too does not look normal. It has the same color scheme of that Yanma and all the other Pokemon here, but Grant can't worry about that now. He's got to battle these two. So he decides to even up the odds, and he sends in his Tyrant. He's not trying to beat her. He's just trying to stall for time. So with Tyrant and Onix, he orders them to both rush in. He orders Onix to use Rock Tomb to create as much of a wall as possible. He's particularly interested in trying to separate the Electrike from Mabel, so he orders Tyrant to rush in and use a Dragon Claw. But this is where a problem begins. The Dragon Claw goes to connect with the Electrike, and normally a trainer would ask their Pokemon to dodge it, but Mabel just lets it come in and it connects with Electrike, but it has no effect. Grant doesn't understand, and he's a bit caught off by this, diverting his attention from the battle and unfortunately allowing his Onix to get taken out by the Weavile. Once Grant snaps back and he realizes what's going on, he recalls Onix and he thinks, great, now all I have just is Tyrant. And it seems that Dragon type moves are ineffective against this Electrike. What is going on here? Over with Alexa, she realizes that she's almost out of time, but it's all right though. Helioptile is making great progress. She's been able to free most of the Pokemon without being noticed. But there is one here that seems extremely shy. Even though she's gotten the cage open, it doesn't want to leave. It doesn't know where to go. This Pokemon is afraid to even move. Alexa recognizes this Pokemon as a Skiddo, but the Skiddo doesn't look like a normal Skiddo. Its color is too off. She doesn't have any time for this. She tries to pull it out of this cage, but it refuses to leave. Alexa thinks to herself, well, the only way I have to get you out of here is to capture you, then fine. She throws a Pokeball at it, and surprisingly, the Pokeball does manage to capture it. It was okay with being in the Pokeball, but it didn't want to leave the cage. It's like it doesn't want to leave the security of a confined area. And with that, all the Pokemon have been free. And it is at this point that Mabel notices that Alexa has freed all these Pokemon, and she turns her attention over to Alexa. Alexa sends out her Noivern, and she orders another Boon Burst, but it's caught by this Electrike and a Thunderbolt. Then, this Electrike fires something at Noivern that Alexa didn't think that it was capable of. A Moonblast. This puts Noivern down. Grant and Alexa are both in awe. They don't understand what's going on here. How is this Electrike Strike able to use a fairy type move like that? It doesn't make any sense. Just then, the chopper for Team Flare's extraction arrives. Mabel is deeply upset about this, but they also have the data that they collected as well. Even though they were unable to gather all the Pokemon at this point, they still have her Electrike and the data on the other Pokemon. With that, she tells Grant and Alexa that this won't be the last they see of her, and she frees the last of the grunts, and they all retreat back to the safety of their base. Alexa rushes over to Noivern to check it. It took a lot of damage from that Moonblast, but it'll be okay. She recalls it back. Helioptile and her head over to Grant and Tyrant. Grant asks Alexa if he saw what he thinks he saw, and Alexa says, "You mean the Moonblast from that Electrike?" Alexa says, "Yeah, so I wasn't crazy. I saw that too." They both agree that this is something that needs to be looked into further, but there's nothing else left here now for them, so they decide to head back into Geosynch Town to meet up with Ash. Once they get back, they inform Ash of what happened out in the forest and how Team Flare was there, gathering up Pokemon of similar coloration to the Yanma. And then Alexa sends out her new Skiddo, which is very shy and very sheepish, and it refuses to go anywhere but by Alexa's side. Alexa thinks this is kind of adorable, while Ash and Grant are kind of dismayed by this. They're more concerned about what's going on with Team Flare right now, and why all these different types of Pokemon are having all these color deformations, and what interest Team Flare has in them. The trio file a report with Officer Jenny, and she takes all their statements. Officer Jenny then asks Alexa if she would leave the Skiddo with her, and she asks Ash if she would leave the Yanma with her as well. The Skiddo refuses to go with Officer Jenny. Even when she tries to recall it, it just jumps and dodges out of the way. It refuses to leave Alexa's side. And as far as Yanma's concerned, it seems to be very aggressive, and it's not going to be something that can be held inside of a Pokeball. So it's agreed that the best place for them is with Ash and Alexa. With that, the trio decide to call it a night, and they settle in. Later on in the night, after everybody in the center is sleeping, Grant has made his way to a private part of the center where he can make, and he calls in over his holocaster to report in, "Listen, there has been some interesting developments. Now, not only has the Kranidos and my Tyrant awakened, but a whole new batch of Pokemon as well. Currently, Alexa has caught a Skiddo of an off coloration, far different from Kranidos and Tyrant, and Ash has caught a Yanma, same coloration as a Skiddo." The voice on the other end of the holocaster says, "Good work. Do you have anything else to report?" Grant says, "Yes. Team Flare is mobilizing even harder now. I do believe that what they have planned has something to do with these Pokemon, which is going to make Ash, me, and Alexa a target, which means it's safe to say that they will be coming back after us soon." The voice on the other end of the holocaster says, "Agreed." Grant then asks, "What are my further orders?" The voice says, "You are to remain with Ash. He needs protection." Grant says, "Agreed." And with that, they end the call. The next day, trio decide that they've done all that they can in Geosynch Town. So they head out Shallower City in the sight of Ash's second gym badge. After about a week or so, they eventually reach Shallower City, and Ash is super pumped. He has been working with Yanma over the last week. The problem is this thing is even tougher than Kranidos. It refuses to do anything that Ash says, and as a result, Ash spends more time recalling it into the Pokeball than actually using it in battle. But that's alright though. He still has three other Pokemon, and he wants his chance to earn his second gym badge. He immediately heads over to the Shallower Gym, and he asks for a chance to battle the gym leader. But the gym attendant says the gym leader is not currently in. She is actually on the other side of the city, at a place called the Tower of Mastery. And that's all we have for part 4 of What If Ash Was Born in Kalos. I really appreciate you guys sticking through with this with me, with my voice. It's been really difficult to record this one after getting over this damn COVID, but I'm getting really antsy and I want to start recording again. But anyway, what do you guys think about today's episode? What do you think about these new variants in colors as well? Yanma, Skiddo, what are they doing in the story now? What's their importance to Team Flare? And of course, who was Grant talking to after everybody was asleep? It's a lot of mystery starting to build up, and Ash is looking to challenge for a second badge, but at first he's got to see what this Tower of Mastery is all about. Anyway, let me know in the comments down below, and if you guys enjoyed the video, please make sure to drop a like, and also, if you haven't already, please subscribe, as it really helps us get to a bigger audience. And if you haven't already, please join the Discord in the link below. There's a lot of like-minded people down there who talk about Pokemon What Ifs, and if you're interested in getting a couple of your own started, that's the place to get support. And also, don't forget to follow me on Twitter, as that's where I post real time of the stuff that I'm working on. So if you want some behind the scenes stuff of what I'm currently working on as I'm doing it, that's the spot to go. And of course, I just want to thank you guys all for giving me the time to recover, and welcome any and all new subscribers to the channel. But anyway, I'm Ronan Charizard, and